Good morning, everyone. My name is Annie Zaidi. I'm going to be moderating this discussion. To start with, I'm going to ask my co-panelists to tell us a little bit more about themselves, the kind of work they practice, and so you know from where they're coming and, you know, are just familiar with the positions they're taking in their work.
Many apologies for my croaky voice. I've brought an English cold with me. I am the, publishing director of Myriad Editions, which is an independent publisher based in the UK. We publish fiction and graphic novels, and we also publish feminist nonfiction. And we have a few of our authors here, which is really nice. It's lovely to see Elizabeth Haynes and Umi Sinha in the audience. We publish a lot of debut writers, and we accept a lot of submissions, so I read a lot of first lines.
Excellent. Thank you. Manu?
Yeah. Hi. I'm Manu Bhattathiri. I have authored two books thus far. Hopefully, this is a beginning for me. So I've written a collection of short stories called Savitri Special Room and a novel called The Town That Laughed. The first was from HarperCollins and the second from Aleph. I've also worked as a journalist for some time, and currently I co-own an advertising agency in Bangalore.
So I write fiction, short stories and novels. I have a published collection from HarperCollins, and I've just finished work on a second collection, and the manuscript is sitting with my publisher, so I'm waiting to hear about it. So living in a state of anxiety right now.
Right. On to our topic then. When I was told I'm going to be on this panel, I was in a little bit of a flap because, to be honest, I couldn't think of a single favorite opening line. So initially my mind just went blank, and then I thought of Jane Austen's famous line from Pride and Prejudice, "It is a truth universally acknowledged that a man of means is must be in need of a wife." And then I thought about, why do I remember this line? Because although I do love Pride and Prejudice, it is certainly not my favorite novel. Why do I remember this line so much? And I think I came to the conclusion it's because it's been quoted so often, you know, particularly in the feminist space and gender spaces. This line is quoted so often that I think it has gotten stuck into my head. Otherwise, perhaps it wouldn't have been. But that said, people do have favorite opening sentences. So perhaps you can share your favorite opening lines.
I thought when I was told I was going to be on this session, I was very excited because when my daughter was little and when the bath was running, we would pull books off the shelf while the bath ran, and we would play this game with each other of just quoting lines and seeing what they were. And then I was thinking about it, and in fact, because I don't have as good a memory as you, I was writing them down, which I particularly liked. But I think what was important about that sort of sense of an opening line is like the one from Pride and Prejudice that you've just quoted. It sets the theme. You know, we know it's going to be about marriage, and we know the tone is going to be ironic. So very quickly you sum it up. And then, and of course, you know, another very oft-quoted one is Tolstoy and Anna Karenina. Happy families are all alike, and every unhappy family is unhappy in its own way. And again, straight away, you know that you're heading for domestic disaster. And I really like, I suppose, you know, and there's Orwell with 1984. It was a bright, cold day in April, and the clocks were striking 13. It just takes you straight into this mad world. So, you know, I have a whole list. We should go on.
Manu, how about
some of yours? Well, it was the best of times, it was the worst of times. Is not really my favorite. Okay. I think that's extraordinarily famous, but it's also very weighty. I'm no one to critique Charles Dickens, but my favorite is, I think one of my favorites is the way Hitchhiker's Guide begins, Douglas Adams. I don't remember the exact quote, He begins with something like, in a very insignificant part of the universe, there lies a very insignificant galaxy. In a very insignificant corner of that galaxy is a small, yellow, unregarded sun. I love that. I love it for reasons. First of all, I think he maintains the theme throughout. It's not just a startling beginning, opening line. The way he maintains it till the end is one thing I really love. And for the value of turning your heads also, I think it's beautiful.
Okay. Vineetha.
So when I first heard about this session, I was wondering, like, there's so many lines I love. So how do I pick from them? It's so hard, you know, because there's so much to love about so many books. But then I also realized that some books that I love, I don't remember the opening or the closing lines. That being said, some of the lines I remember, and I really go back to them all the time. One is Virginia Woolf's Mrs. Dalloway. Mrs. Dalloway said she would buy the flowers herself. And later I read another novel, a recent novel called The Hours, which has been made into a brilliant film. Again, the line is sort of a riff. He uses it so well in that book. So like you were saying, some lines just stick with us because they are recycled again and again by different authors. Then there's another book that I love called Bel Canto, which is by Ann Patchett, the American writer. And it opens with the line, "When the lights went off, the accompanist kissed her." That's all, that's the opening line. And from there on, you know, it's a beautiful story about a kidnapping in a South American country. And it's about music, it's about love, it's about terrorism, it's about the mad world that we live in. But that one line sort of sets off the story so well.
Right. So yesterday I went looking for good opening lines, lines that are acknowledged universally as great opening lines. Maybe I'll read out a few. Orwell has already been quoted as, you know, it was a bright cold day in April and the clocks were striking 13. Again, Anna Karenina's opening line, "All happy families are like." There's one from a novel called The Go-Between by L.P. Hartley, which is again a very quoted first line. "The past is a foreign country. They do things differently there," which is again a great opening line. Tale of Two Cities, Charles Dickens, Best of Times, Worst of Times. Metamorphosis from Franz Kafka. "As Gregor Samsa awoke one morning from uneasy dreams, he found himself transformed in his bed into monstrous vermin." Slaughterhouse-Five by Kurt Vonnegut. "All this happened, more or less." Okay, so The Color Purple. "You better not never tell nobody but God." These are great opening lines, and I think we can all agree that one of the things that these great opening lines do is they suck you straight into the heart of the story. There's no beating around the bush too much. I'd like to ask other people on the panel about what shaped their influences and what shaped their reading habits. Because finally, I think the kind of writing we produce, the kind of writing we endorse and inhabit becomes is drawn from our influences, our reading influences when we were growing up. Would you like to comment on that?
Yeah, I have often asked myself why I read. So I believe it's because I would like to maintain my sanity. So I think for me, I have a need to live in many worlds at once. I cannot be contained to one routine, one life. It kind of depresses me. So whenever I read, I live among characters of that novel. So I think the day I stop reading is when I feel really depressed. So it's for that I read primarily. That apart, of course, I believe every human being has a need to connect with others, with their fellow beings, to know more about them. So writing helps a lot because the way you connect with another reader, it's a more intimate connection than you would otherwise have yourself believe. Because writing comes from the heart, if it's worthwhile. And when you read that, you're directly accessing the writer's heart. And there is a connect from a remote place, somewhere else. You sit in Bangalore today and you connect with, say, a Dostoevsky of 200 years ago. It's a beautiful feeling. So I think that's why I read. And that is also what motivates me to write, because I believe reading is only half the job. So you've got to do your bit. And again, it helps you maintain order in your lives when you really get out what is contained within you.
Yeah, I think that's a theme that I've heard on a lot of panels that keeps coming up, is that we, when we read, we're transported somewhere else. We can go backwards in time, we can go forwards in time, we can go to different places. And I think that that's certainly something that everybody shares, and that's why we're all coming to the literary festival. My own influences, well, I was asked this yesterday and said it, Daphne du Maurier was who really got me reading as a child, I think, or a young teenager. And also I had my big brother was reading a lot of French literature, and that felt very important to read Camus and Sartre. And I'm sure a lot of it I didn't understand when I was first reading it, but I really liked that. And I think, and then of course with a British education system, you read quite canonically, you know, from Shakespeare, from Chaucer, Shakespeare, and through. And so my reading was very influenced by that for a long time. And then I did a PhD on Henry James. Oh no, I did an MA on Henry James, and then a PhD I started working more on feminist and more political writing, because I felt that actually my reading was very different from the life I was living. So I was politically becoming a feminist and I was protesting and going on marches, and yet I was deeply immersed in Henry James. It seemed two completely different worlds. And so I suppose one of the joys of publishing and going into publishing for me was that I could bring those two halves together. So, you know, in a way it was no accident that my early publishing career was at a feminist publisher. And that then to me was a real joy of discovering people like Alice Walker and Zora Neale Hurston and reading. And I think I still find that, and that is what is such a real privilege of being a publisher, is that you are constantly learning and learning more, and every book that I read and that we publish is just takes you on another journey, which is, you know, a great place to be.
Vineetha, would you like to?
So I actually read for all the reasons that you already mentioned. Apart from that, I also feel that, like, right, I started reading very early, and I was always reading inappropriate books. Basically, they would say that this is not for kids. Like, you know, you shouldn't be reading this. But it was always like, it was out of my reach, but I would still sort of reach for it. So there was a kind of challenge to reading, a thrill to it, which I still feel as an adult. Also the fact that reading, especially fiction, sort of questions reality, because I don't think fiction writers are very happy with the way things are. So there's always room to question, which we don't often get in real life. Like, mostly people like you if you don't ask too many questions about reality. So it's a really nice place to hear voices which share your questions and which sort of question the way the world is working, the way we interact with each other, relationships, how they're structured. All of these are questioned in stories and novels, which I find very exciting, which I find that expands my thinking and makes me a better writer.
Could you, so to kind of carry on from there, you mentioned that some of your favorite novels don't have kind of very great or very memorable opening sentences. Is the opening sentence really a deal breaker? And if not, then why is there this, that you must have a great opening sentence?
So to answer the question about the deal breaker, no, I don't think, like personally speaking, a lot of books that I love, I can't remember what the first line is. I can name one, Michael Ondaatje's The English Patient. I've read it so many times, it's like my Bible. I've got a really old paperback copy by my desk. But if you ask me what's the first line or what's the last line, I really can't quote the lines. So I don't think we should make a fetish out of the first line and the last line. But that being said, of course, it's extremely important. It sort of sets the tone. It takes you into the story. And it makes you want to read the second line.
Yeah.
If the first line just puts you to sleep, why do you want to read the second and the third and the fourth line, you know? So it is important, but it's not all important.
Manu, what about you?
Well, see, for me, when I write, I don't really try to get the first line right. Because I would say it's more like something my wife says or my friends say. I just turn it around in my head. And one day the first line happens. So I don't know, being an advertising guy, we write a lot of punchlines. Mm. So I would hate to think it's the same process that might go into writing the first line of a novel. I would really hate to think that, because I don't think, firstly, I'm suspect about, you know, when a writer is trying to draw a reader too much, I don't really agree with that process. I think when you have something to say, you're going to be heard, right? And when you don't have anything to say, don't write. I mean, sorry to say that, but it is when a writer feels that he can't help writing that he starts writing. So it's not really the first sentence that matters. Now, having said that, there are many famous first sentences. I don't really believe any of them have changed anybody's lives, but yet they are famous for a reason. I agree with that. There are, I would say, more than punch, the first sentence should be relevant and apt for the context and for the entire story. So if at any point while I'm reading a book, I feel, okay, this author has begun the first sentence very greatly, very stunningly, and then I start getting bored with the novel, or not bored, just even a little let down, the first punchy first line is going to have a very negative impact on me, because I'm going to feel that he has tried to draw me into something that I'm not interested in. So that way, I don't think I would ever attempt to write a first sentence which is extremely, extraordinarily punchy or anything.
But if you get it right, it's great.
Absolutely.
You know, it's
absolutely.
If you write a killer first line, yes. Fantastic.
Absolutely.
But don't try too hard.
Yes. I think the spontaneity is more important than, you know, kind of getting it right.
Candida, coming in as a publisher, is the first line a deal breaker for you? And if people are obsessing about first lines, what would you tell them?
I think it's, with submissions, it's really interesting because often, I mean, yeah, it's great if there's a first line, and if it, by extension, more, you need more than the first line. And I think it's lovely to hear you saying you don't want to just do an appetizing, that sort of pitch. It's a novel or a collection of short stories is very different. I think by extension of the first line fetish, what we see a lot is manuscripts sent from people who've clearly been on a creative writing course, and they have been encouraged to really hone the first three chapters of their work. And these are, you can tell they've been really, 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 really worked on. And the rest of the novel is incredibly baggy and just uncrafted. And so I would discourage that, you know, concentrating on the beginning. At the other end of that, though, I think that quite often I see something, read a manuscript, that there's obviously something there, but actually it's not there in the beginning. And you do read on, and in fact, the author has, by about sort of chapter 7, got into their own rhythm, and they've relaxed into it, and then you can, there's this sort of sense of relief that, oh, fine, okay, you're now confident that you're in safe hands and they've got a story to tell. And that's where, then it becomes a very joyous experience, because then it becomes a collaborative process, and you might say, actually, let's start, not at the beginning, let's start here, let's lose the first 6 chapters.
Wow, you're losing 6 chapters is not a happy thought, but well, you're the publisher. Okay, so given that perhaps the first line is not that important, perhaps even the first chapter isn't that important, should one then not worry at all about beginnings or when? Because when you start reading a book, I as a reader, when I pick up a book, there's only so much time I'll give the writer before the writer loses me. So at what point does the writer lose you?
The reader.
Well, I think, I mean, I didn't mean to say that the first lines weren't important. I mean, clearly they are. And clearly, you know, we get a lot of submissions and you don't read them all. So you have to, there has to be something there to carry on. And I think certainly if you haven't got it by chapter 7, then you're lost, whether it's published or unpublished. So, because we haven't got time to persist in this. But I was just thinking, going back to the sense of the beginning and the importance of the beginning, and they're actually, of the two myriad authors sitting here, both of their books begin with a prologue. And I think if you begin with a prologue, it is incredibly important that you get that right, because it's there, it's very framed. And in fact, poor Umi Sinha, I had to rewrite her prologue a few times, and I still feel very apologetic for asking her to do that. But that was because it just feels like if you call something a prologue, you are saying, here, you know, here is a piece, and it's got to be from the right point of view, in the right tense, and to get the reader.
Okay. Manu, how long would you persist with a novel before setting it aside?
Actually, quite soon. I would say I'm not looking for any punch anywhere. But having said that, if I have, say, read a couple of chapters, say about 50 pages, and absolutely nothing is happening, then I'm going to leave it aside. It's a decision that I've taken off late. Actually, I think it might have something to do with my age and experience in life. Because I think some time back, maybe when I was in college or something, I just like to say I've read that book. And so I would somehow go through with it. But then I even remember the day when I thought that, you know, there's no point in doing this. If the book is, sometimes a book might be good, famous, but it's just not for you. It's possible. I'm saying that the greatest classics of literature may not indeed be for everyone. Somebody may not be interested. So I think it's a very personal experience, the experience of reading. So there's no need to go by the book's fame or any review that you have read. If you are just not gelling with the book, I think you should set it aside. Maybe the loss at times is yours. It could happen that after 5 chapters is when the author really warmed up. But then this is not a message to the author. But I would say that's an accident in this whole process. There's no way that you can really, otherwise you'll end up reading boring books and then you'll be complaining. So I set aside a book after, say, around 50 pages if I just not warm up to it.
Do you go back to a book, though? Because I think there are some books that have become, say, bestsellers, and that you start and you think, I don't get this. I don't understand why. And then you keep, you know, you try again because, well, I do. It's sort of like, why is this so popular? Why is it being reviewed everywhere? It hasn't sort of got me.
Yeah. Well, that happens quite often, actually, because, you know, you don't agree with the critic's point of view, or a book has become really popular, but you don't get it. So like you said, I think it's extremely personal. But I don't feel the compulsion as a reader to agree with the reviewer or to agree with all the hype that has gone on. I think we have the freedom as readers to decide what we want to do. But as a writer, I also feel that we owe the authors a little bit of patience. So instead of sort of dismissing in the first 20 pages and saying, okay, nothing's happening, or, you know, I sort of persist for a while because I feel this kinship with writers. I think that, okay, no, maybe, you know, it'll warm up in a bit. So I have much more patience with books than with people. So I give it a lot more time and I stick with it. So, but that's just me.
Wow, you guys are patient. I give up after 3 pages. Unless I'm being paid to read something. Okay, great. So, if this is not absolutely a deal breaker, an opening line, or even an opening page, then what is absolutely critical? what is it that keeps a reader reading, and what keeps publishers publishing, and what keeps us sort of, what is the power of the book then?
I think it's the attitude of the author. Like I said, no book is for everyone. Mm-hmm. I really can't believe that, initially when you are studying, for example, when you're doing a literature, whatever is given to you, you have to read. But you later realize that no book in the world is really for everyone. Even the best, even Shakespeare has been criticized. Right. Some people have found Shakespeare boring, they've told me. So you can't say anything about that. Dostoevsky has been thought to be very dark and gloomy and depressing. I find him extremely funny at times. Mm. I don't know. I think the reader gels with the attitude of the writer rather than even the content. The content comes in later if the attitude is right. If the process of the writing, that has gone into the writing, is somewhere connecting with the process of the reader as he reads, I think the bridge is established, and that is when the reader will go on. So I don't believe the writer can really do too much to ensure that a certain audience will read him. Mm. I don't believe that.
I agree with you. Maybe it is about the spirit. The number of young boys who love Portnoy's Complaint is just astounding. And I think it's really just the spirit rather than the story.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. I also feel it's like the connect that the reader feels with the characters. So, even if you sort of don't understand the setting or the politics of the story, or you don't feel like, it's not moving fast enough, if you sort of relate to a particular character or to the relationship between two characters, or just like one character, like he's so funny or he's so lovely, like the way he speaks. There have been books which have just hooked me because I felt this connection with the character, and then it became a relationship because I persisted with the book and it went on like that. Mm. So I think character plays a big role in fiction.
Mm. I have something to add.
Would you agree?
I am reading The Tin Drum right now by Gundagrass. So that is entirely history, okay? A specific time, World War I and after. So it's Germany and Poland, and I fundamentally find this painful, actually, because it's very, first of all, I don't know history, but the book is written so well to, as far as I'm concerned. It's so magical that I, in fact, called my daughter, who is very interested in history, and I asked her, tell me this, okay, tell me what happened at that time. And she sat and she explained to me how Poland was attacked by Germany and blah, blah, and stuff like that. And then I went back to the book and started reading. So I believe the content, though it might be not so interesting to you, if the attitude of the writer is so stunning as far as the reader is concerned that he cannot let go, then he will make it his business to get into the content and understand it. Mm. That's what I believe. Yeah.
Also the language, like language plays a big role in attracting you to a book, right? It's like if it's written beautifully, I don't mean like in an empty sort of way, it has substance, but the, the sentences flow, the words are arranged in a particular way, there's a music to the language. I think that holds readers, many readers would relate to it. Mm.
Yes, I think it depends a lot as well in the context in which you're reading. Whether you're reading for pleasure, whether you're on a journey, whether you're reading because you think you should read that book, thing.
I think whether like for you it is work.
Or whether it's for work. But I'm just thinking now the sort of the non-work as well. And I think, I think for both actually, for submissions too, there is a sense of fundamentally it's about storytelling. And I think what I want is to feel confident that I'm in the hands of a good storyteller. Yeah. Now that might come through as something that is a plot-driven crime novel, or it might come through as you're saying in this character that you are just really immediately as this compelling character or the voice. I think where I find it hard is where I get a bit lost, is where there might be a character or an aspect of the novel that you're just completely there with. but to the extent that, rather like if you're watching a play and the main character goes off stage, it's like suddenly,
what happened?
You know, the if that character isn't there, the novel seems flat. And that's, I think, yeah, at the point where you're tempted to skip pages. And that's a flaw, I think. You shouldn't, you know, you need to keep that attention, yeah, there, I think.
Okay, great. I have just a couple more questions and not that much time. Okay. There is this question of, to me this is an interesting concept as a writer, that should I care at all about engaging the reader? It is a deeper sort of, I guess, almost a spiritual, certainly both a personal and a kind of larger literary world question of why should I care about engaging the reader if my principal motivation is to just write about the things that I want to write? And I'd be interested in hearing all your views about that.
Hmm. Go on.
I cannot say that you can be totally independent of the thought of engaging the reader. Really can't say it that much, because why are you publishing it? If it's entirely you and your words and your book, then you can just write it and keep it somewhere. Like Kafka did, I think, initially. he was worried for the world.
He wanted to destroy his work.
Yes, yes.
He wanted to burn them.
He wanted to burn them, and luckily there was Max Brod, yeah, I think, who saved it for us. But I don't think you can be totally disengaged from the thought of the reader. But what I do feel is trying to please everybody is not going to happen. Like, you want your books to be read by the maximum number of people, fair enough, but you can't be writing for that. I think there is, it's very nuanced what I'm trying to say. It's subtle, because you are writing with somebody in mind. But to me, supposing I write a book, okay, nobody reads it. And just one person reads it. And that one person's life is changed. Mm-hmm. How would you judge the book? I think it's fine. It's great. I've done a big, great job, right? So it can't be in numbers. I think if somebody, some section of readers, anywhere, sitting anywhere in the world at any point in time, warms up your book, then it's a success. Yeah. Success. That's what I believe.
I think a lot depends of what you were touching on is what you want from writing. I think that if you want to be published, you have to engage a reader, because you know the publisher wants to sell the book, you want to sell the book. But the obverse of that is that I think it's really important to write in your voice and to, yeah, discover your voice and what you want to write about. And for many writers, that doesn't happen straight away. You know, you're trying different forms, and I think it's quite hard for emerging writers often to know what voice they should be writing in, what genre, and to feel comfortable with it. And I think that there is a commercial imperative that is so strong that is sort of like, oh, I must write a psychological thriller or a crime novel because then my world will be changed overnight. Well, actually, your voice might be more suited to a short story or to poetry. And I think that that's really important in the growing of a writer, in the learning to be a writer, is what I think you might have been alluding to, is that know yourself, you know?
I think there's a flip side to it as well. So if you just do your writing and then suddenly you meet someone who's read your book and they've connected with it, and this person is not the person you had in mind, or so what I'm saying is, unexpectedly, people do connect with what you've written. Yes. So it's not like you're an advertiser and you're targeting all the people who eat chips. Yes. So you write a, you know, line for them. So writing fiction and poetry is not like that. So you sort of leave it to the universe, you do your best, you tell your authentic story. Like you're saying, you use your voice and you tell the best story. And people do connect. Like for an example, all the stories in my first book are set in Delhi. So I would never think that someone who's never been to India, never knows anything about Delhi, would relate to it. And then I went to New Mexico for a residency and I met this woman there who read the book. And she was really excited about the stories. She's never traveled out of the US. She doesn't even have a passport. So I'm saying that, you know, she's not someone I wrote for, but she really related to it. So happy accidents do happen. So you don't have to stress yourself out about, okay, this is who I'm writing for, and this is what I'll put in. It's not that deliberate.
Candida, because you're a publisher, would you tell the audience what you look for in a first page or in an opening, or what is it that drives things for you?
This is a question that's asked, I think, of every publisher, and I think that fortunately we all answer. Well, we all say the same, I think, actually. We all say we want to be grabbed, and we want to, you know, a special voice, and we want to just be, just something to grab us, whether it's a voice, whether it's a character, whether it's a story. But I think that the saving grace is that it's all actually comes down to taste, and we all have very different tastes. So what I like, I don't know if there's many writers in the room, but what one publisher likes, another one won't, and vice versa. And so I always say to people, never, never, ever give up, because there is no science about it. It is an art, and it is ultimately all about taste, and it's about matchmaking. Basically, publishers are really matchmakers. You know, it's sort of like this works really well. I know who will be the reader for this novel. I know who will be the German publisher for this novel. I know which festival that would like this novel. You know, it's that, I think, is it's an industry based on taste.
Okay, I'm being given signs that we are out of time. Are we out of time?
Yes, yes. So now, if you have any questions, please raise your hands.
Good afternoon, everyone. I think while talking about all the first sentences, we forgot to talk about the last ones.
Oh, yeah, we didn't talk about last ones.
I was going to, but we are out of time.
So, like, any particular last sentences for you people, any favorite ones? Or by any chance, are there any novels which have both the favorite first and the last sentences? Okay. Like, I'm sorry, I'm taking a little more time, but we forgot to talk about one of the most important, I mean, I guess one of the most famous, if not important, first sentences. Mr. and Mrs. Dursley of number 4 Private Drive are happy to say that they are perfectly normal. Thank you very much. That was probably Harry Potter. And then it also has a very famous last line as well, which goes as, his car had not pained him for last 19 years, all was well. So it's a series which has the first famous first line of the first book and the famous last line of the last book. So I think that's a peculiarity in itself. Yeah. So any other books like these?
Yeah, I thank you for this question, because I thought we would never get to the end. I don't know whether it's my favorite last line, but I think it's the last line that is incredibly important. Last line is in Jean Rhys's Wild Sargasso Sea, because basically it was the last couple of lines of that. You see Antoinette, otherwise known as Bertha, holding her candle and basically setting out to burn down the house of Mr. Rochester. And that book, the last line of that book, it's not an ending, it takes you straight back into another novel, and to a certain extent Jean Rhys depends on the reader's knowledge of Jane Eyre, because when you've read that, you will never read Jane Eyre in the same way again. It takes you straight back to reconsidering everything about Jane Eyre. So I think that's an incredibly important last line.
You could also just have like one word as the last line, you know, like The God of Small Things, yes, which is one of my favorite books. So it just says Nale, which means tomorrow. It's just a word, but it has so much meaning, because there is no tomorrow for them, and it's just, you know, disaster from then on. It's also how the story loops back to the beginning, and so it's like a killer line. For me, that's like one of the great, it's just one word.
I'll go back to the galaxy. again, I can't quote exactly, but the last line is something like, for sure there was a point to this whole thing, but at present, it escapes the mind of the chronicler. So I love that.
Oh, tomorrow reminded me, one of my favorite endings is from Gone with the Wind, Scarlett O'Hara, that she's tomorrow. A fighter right through. Mm. Like she has the spirit of not giving up, and that's how it ends. Like, you know, the man in her life has left, and then she says, tomorrow's another day. This was her sort of motto in life. Tomorrow's another day. You live and fight another day. So that is another great line. I did copy down a couple of, again, these are not my favorite last lines, but they're universally acknowledged as great last lines. I will just read out one to you. This is from The Lighthouse by Virginia Woolf. It says, yes, she thought, laying down her brush in extreme fatigue. I have had my vision. So she's sort of looking for a vision and then she finds it. And this is from The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn by Mark Twain. And Huck Finn says, but I reckon I got to light out for the territory ahead of the rest because Aunt Sally, she's going to adopt me and civilize me and I can't stand it. I have been there before. Yeah. So, yes. One last question, maybe?
While I agree with you guys that there is no point in being fetish about the first line, but I think the first paragraph is really very important. Because if you are not able to arrest the attention of the reader in the first paragraph, he's likely to put the book aside and perhaps picking it up at another time again to get disappointed because his first impression is prejudiced against you. What is your take?
It's like a conversation. Like if you meet someone and they, you know, what they say is really boring at the start, why will you stick with the conversation? You want to end it quickly and leave. So it's similar to like a human conversation. Mm-hmm. You want to have something interesting in the beginning to make everybody stick around. That's what I feel.
Well, I believe every word is important. It's not that the first sentence is not important. I think it is important. Every word of the novel is important. But the desire to create an impact in the right in the first line is what I would not encourage in an author.
Just reminded of I think the novel is Love in the Time of Cholera, Marcus. So it begins with something very relevant, the suicide of that painter. So, I mean, it gets interesting, but then it doesn't have much relevance, according to me, in the whole novel. So
maybe it's a bad beginning. I mean, there's nothing like, just because it's a classic, it's right. In fact, if you see Dostoevsky, all beginnings are typically boring, to me. It's like, you know, in the village of K, and there'll be one line there, he won't mention the name. So there lived a barber or a tailor or somebody who used to stitch cloth, something like that. So you can't say it's right or wrong. Yeah.
It could be just like a thing of beauty, you know, like in the beginning. Isn't this the one with the smell of bitter almonds? The first line. It's a beautiful line about how it reminds him of unrequited love.
It's very beautiful. Isn't I mean, it's it? Catchy.
Yes.
It makes us read, but then...
Yeah, but so I'm saying we can cherish it for what it is. Like, it's a beautiful line.
Not like it, not like it. I mean, it's just a point.
Right.
I think my own experience with reading and with first lines and end lines and all of that is I think what happens is that you read a book, you love it, and then you go back to the first line and say that's a great first line. There is no bad book out there whose first line is celebrated. So I think really it's that...
Yeah.
It's only in retrospect that you say that, oh, that was a great first line,
yeah.
I feel.
Yeah,
that, or the last line for that matter. Yeah. If the rest of the book is bad, you don't even notice how it begins and ends. Mm.
Sure.
Yeah. Just one more trivia over here. I heard, but then I haven't actually read. There's a Malayalam novel by C.V. Raman Pillai called Martanda Varma. The first sentence is a big paragraph. I mean, is it true? Okay. Just a trivia.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you've been hooked by the first line, the first paragraph, the first page, chapter, and you've traveled through the work, the entire novel, then is the last sentence very important as a writer? I mean, do they really focus on the last sentence? Because the entire book has already made an impression of you. So what's your opinion on that?
Well, as a writer, I do obsess about every sentence, whether it's the last line or it's in the middle or, because, you know, you have this feeling that you have to get it right. So more than the last line, I think it's the ending. You want to get the ending right. Because you can't, it's not like a Bollywood movie where you just tag on the ending and then hope that all will be well. Like you just bring in the ending from outside the story. It has to be organic. It has to fit in really well with the way things have been moving. So I think more than the very last line, it's the ending that you tend to work on.
Yes, I think I completely agree. I think that we carry with us through the novel an expectation of the ending. You know, it might be that we want the murder to be solved, or we want the man to get the girl, or whatever it is. And I think also there are endings that can really, the reader can feel betrayed. And I think Atonement was, Ian McEwan's Atonement was that sort of book where we had invested in Cecilia and Robbie all the way through wrongful imprisonment and fighting in the war, and their love seemed to sort of survive. And then to learn at the end that actually half of the story of their lives was not only a figment of Ian McEwan's imagination, but also of little sister Bryony's, it was audaciously brilliant ending, but there's, first of all, that sort of, what?
Yeah, for me as a writer, the ending is something I'm very finicky about, because I think, you might have got the beginning right, and you might have got the whole novel right, but if you don't do the ending well, it's like a rough landing. So people are going to forget what right you did before that. So sometimes I do go back and correct my endings and stuff like that. So I think it's not like I'm trying to create some impact or anything, or conclusive endings or anything like that. But I think it is important to get the ending right, certainly.
Okay, is there one more question? Or if there isn't, I can tell a joke.
You can tell a joke.
I can tell a joke.
You can tell
a joke. I was looking at my Facebook feed and I saw a meme, and it was really funny, speaking of opening sentences. There are two characters, and one character in the cartoon says that, do all fairy tales begin with once upon a time? Because that's how all fairy tales begin. And the other character says, no, that's also some fairy tales begin with if I get elected in the forthcoming elections. So that's nice. Also how some stories go.